All right, we left off talking about meiosis, and we're going to talk about some of the problems that arise if the segregation of chromosomes in meiosis is defective. But before we do that, I want to draw a stark contrast between meiosis and mitosis. And the features of meiosis that we need to focus on are that there is synapsis and crossing over. That is, homologous chromosomes pair in meiosis, but do not in meiosis, in mitosis rather. So synapsis of homologous chromosomes occurs in meiosis, but not mitosis. And furthermore, in meiosis, there is crossing over, that is exchange of genetic material between chromatids on sister chromosomes. So we'll illustrate that in a little while. And in meiosis one, the first meiotic division, the sister chromatids remain joined. At anaphase, they do not separate, rather they go together to the same pole, and that is because the kinetochores of sister chromatids on the same chromosome, in other words, attach to the same pole, the microtubules from the same pole in meiosis one. Naturally, that does not happen in mitosis. And we have two cell divisions in the case of meiosis, but DNA replication does not occur between those cell divisions. Now, between every mitosis, of course, there is an S phase in which the genome is replicated. That is not true between meiosis one and meiosis two. And because of that, and subsequent, and the successive, I should say, two cell divisions of meiosis, that results in a halving, cutting in half of the genetic material in the production of gametic products. Now let's look at how, briefly, let's look at how these chromosomes, what types of variability can be generated in terms of the gametic inheritance of chromosomes. So if we have a paternal gamete here, let's say three red chromosomes, and a maternal gamete, say three blue chromosomes, that results in a diploid genotype where we have three pairs of chromosomes. Nothing unusual about that. And then we can consider, well, given this arrangement of chromosomes, three sets of homologous chromosomes, what are the combinations of those chromosomes that can end up in potential gametes? And if we have three different homologous chromosomes pairs, three different pairs of chromosomes, we can generate 2^3 or 8 different possible combinations of those chromosomes that are inherited in potential gametes. So we could have three reds in a gamete, three blues, two reds in a blue, two blues in a red, and different combinations of those. 8 possible different combinations are possible. If there were 4 pairs of homologous chromosomes that we were dealing with, there would be 16 possible potential gametes in terms of the chromosomes that they inherit. And that is because, and this is a very important point to keep in mind before we enter into transmission genetics, Mendelian genetics, that is because the chromosomes are independent in the way they can line up at the metaphase plate. So for example, in meiosis one, we could have the homologs line up so that all three blues are on one side of the plate and all three reds are on the other side of the meiosis one metaphase plate, or vice versa, the reds on the left and blues on the right. On the other hand, we could have two of the blues on the left and one red. Two reds and one blue would be on the other side of the plate. And different combinations can arise in terms of how they line up on the metaphase plate. And we will see later on that this is the basis for Mendel's second law of inheritance, the law of independent assortment of genes. And that is because genes are carried on chromosomes. So we'll come across this again. Now, what happens if there are, I want to emphasize one more point, and that is that meiosis then produces haploid gametes that are non-identical. They are not identical to each other. And so, whereas mitosis produces cells that are identical to each other, assuming no mutations have occurred. So meiosis does a very different thing than mitosis. And let's ask how those different genotypes of haploid cells arise. They arise from crossing over, the exchange of genetic material between sister chromatids, between chromatids of homologous chromosomes. So we have homologous chromosomes that have replicated, and there can be crossing over between chromatids of homologous chromosomes. And the random alignment that we've just talked about of homologous chromosomes at the metaphase one, that will be the basis for independent assortment, as we will see. Whereas mitosis always produces two cells that are identical to each other. And those processes are compared on these next two slides, and you can pause this movie to examine it. Basically, mitosis goes through a process which produces two daughter cells that are identical to each other, whereas, this is mitosis down here, whereas meiosis will result in four daughter cells, each of which are genetically unique, are different from each other. So you can examine that process on your own. Now, what happens if there are defects in meiosis, in the segregation of chromosomes in meiosis? Let's imagine a case where we're looking at one pair of homologous chromosomes here. We'll say a red and a blue one for one pair of homologous chromosomes. And let's say that there is an event called non-disjunction that occurs, and there's a mistake made. And instead of one homologous replicated chromosome going to one pole and the other to the other pole, they both go to the same pole. In that case, you'll end up with a cell at the end of meiosis one, which has two replicated homologous chromosomes for one of the pairs of homologous chromosomes in the organism, and another cell which lacks altogether a member of that chromosome pair. And then in subsequent meiosis two, when the chromatids separate, we will end up with this cell over here will give rise to two cells, each of which have two chromosomes of that homologous set. And two cells will be generated from this cell on the left here that lack any, they lack any copy of that particular chromosome. And then let's ask what happens, for example, if these are eggs, if these are going to be egg cells, let's ask what happens when any of these cells are fertilized by a normal sperm carrying one copy of that homologous chromosome set. Well, and if either of these eggs are fertilized by normal sperm carrying one chromosome of that set, then we will end up with zygotes that have three copies of that chromosome. And we call that condition trisomy. So this would be a trisomy for that particular chromosome. Three bodies, in other words. There are three members of that chromosome set if either of these eggs are fertilized by a normal sperm. Whereas fertilization by these cells, either of these eggs, by a sperm carrying one copy will result in a case where we have a single copy of that chromosome instead of the normal two copies. So we're for that chromosome, we are monosomic. We have monosomy for that chromosome here. And usually this condition or this condition is lethal in humans anyway. And that is usually, those would end up as spontaneous abortions. They would not be viable, unless we're talking about trisomy for chromosome 21. And that leads to Down's syndrome. So trisomy for chromosome 21 results from Down's syndrome. And there is a reason why the incidence of Down syndrome increases with maternal age. If you look at maternal age here in humans versus the incidence of Down syndrome, you see that after about age 35, there is a rise in the incidence of Down syndrome. This marks an inflection point. And that is why women who become pregnant after age 35 are recommended to have their embryos, their fetuses, characterized in terms of their chromosome content by either amniocentesis, in which fluid is removed from the sac around the embryo, and the embryo is sloughing off cells, and so cells can be obtained there and cultured, and then their chromosome contents looked at to look for trisomy of 21, looking for trisomy 21. And in which case the couple, if there is trisomy, the couple who is having the baby could choose to abort that fetus or not, depending on how they feel about raising a Down syndrome child, or obviously bring it to term, and many parents choose to bring those fetuses to term. So that could be, so the karyotypes of the fetus could be obtained by amniocentesis or by chorionic villi sampling, which can occur at a much earlier, that procedure can be done at an earlier stage. And a karyotype can be obtained looking for trisomy of chromosome 21. All right. Now here's an interesting case. This is a real case scenario here. We're looking at the karyotype, the chromosome composition of the father, the mother, and then this is a spontaneously aborted fetus. This was a miscarriage relatively late at about 5 weeks of pregnancy. And what you see here is that this fetus, which was spontaneously aborted on its own, essentially, it died. It was triploid. That is, it wasn't just trisomic for one of the sets of chromosomes. Rather, all the chromosome sets had three copies of a chromosome. So this is not trisomy. This is a true triploid, as opposed to diploid. So we have three sets of chromosomes for the entire chromosome set, for all 20, three pairs of, would be pairs of chromosomes. In this case, there are three of each. And this was a female. There are three X chromosomes, no Y chromosome here. So this female fetus actually had three chromosomes for every chromosome in the set and was therefore lethal. Now you might ask yourself, how did this arise? How did that arise? And you said, you, one answer would be, well, you had the type of non-disjunction that we're talking about, but it happened for all the chromosomes. There was complete non-disjunction. That is, you produced eggs that had, by virtue of non-disjunction at meiosis one, you had eggs with two members of every chromosome pair. And then when that was fertilized by a normal sperm carrying one copy for each chromosome set, you ended up with trisomy for every chromosome set, in which case you would be triploid. But that would be extremely unlikely. So here what we have is a case of polyspermy, most likely polyspermy, where a normal egg is fertilized by two sperm. Now that's fairly rare, and there are mechanisms that have evolved to prevent polyspermy, but mistakes are made. And so this is clearly a case of a natural abortion that was caused by the fertilization of a normal egg by two normal sperm, resulting in triploidy. And with that, we will move on to classical Mendelian genetics. And we will see the correlation between chromosome behavior in meiosis and the behavior of genes and how they are partitioned to gametes and then passed on to the next generation.